Hi, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Chris Johnson. I'm the Freeman Chair in China Studies here at CSIS. Thank you all for coming today for the rollout of our new report, which we've entitled Decoding China's Emerging Great Power Strategy in Asia. Let me just offer a little background on the project itself, why we chose to do this study this particular time, and then we'll get right into it. In 2013, the Sasakawa Peace Foundation in Japan and CSIS established a bilateral commission of distinguished policymakers and scholars to develop a strategic vision for the forward progress of the U.S.-Japan Defense Alliance. The commission, which is co-chaired on the U.S. side by Richard Armitage, former Deputy Secretary of State, and our President and CEO, John Hamre, and on the Japanese side by former Ambassador to the United States, Ryozo Kato, has convened twice, most recently in January 2014 here in Washington. The Sasakawa Peace Foundation provided the funding that we used to conduct this research, and it is designed to help inform the Commission's deliberations. So it is a supplement to those deliberations rather than a specific project related to the Commission. The analysis is ours here at CSIS. But we're very, very thankful, of course, to the Sasakawa Peace Foundation for their support of the project, their continuing support of using our Asia team here at CSIS to contribute to the Commission's deliberations. Let me just briefly introduce my colleagues. We have Matt Goodman, our Simon Chair in Political Economy, Dr. Victor Cha, our Korea Chair. To his left, Ernie Bauer, our Sumitru Chair in Southeast Asian Studies here, and to his left, Nick Sucheney, who is our Deputy Director of our Japan program here, sitting in for Mike Green, who is today in London. We'd like to just start off with a very quick, almost sort of movie trailer-like video, just to kind of give you a sense of what we were trying to accomplish, and then we'll get right into it.
President Xi Jinping, born to power as the leader of the People's Republic, is the strongest Chinese leader to emerge in more than a decade. He is consolidating his grasp on the Chinese Communist Party much more quickly than his immediate predecessors. Xi's aggressive efforts to gain control over the People's Liberation Army, the security services, and the party bureaucracy speak to his recognition of the notion that the top leader must control the key levers of power to effectively wield authority in a Leninist system like China's. The establishment of two new high-level policy bodies during last fall's third plenum indicates Xi has the clout to outmaneuver bureaucratic obstacles that could block his bold policy vision. However, it also underscores the resistance he and his reforms are facing. Taking decisive action so quickly after taking office gives Xi the remaining 9 years of his term to focus on implementing measures that address China's many economic ailments. Among them, declining productivity growth and thorny fiscal issues between the central and local governments. Positioning the economy to unlock the next major wave of sustained growth is essential to achieving Xi's Chinese dream that in turn facilitates the great rejuvenation of the Chinese nation. While Xi may be well on his way to gaining the power necessary to force his peers to embrace this vision at home, there are few clues about what these concepts might mean for the Xi administration's behavior globally. The world is waiting to see how Xi will manage China's desire for good relations with its neighbors while asserting its sovereignty over contested territories nearby. Are Xi's aggressive moves at home a harbinger of a more determined quest for regional dominance? What are the factors shaping China's emerging strategy in Asia, and how is the region likely to respond?
Okay, well, with that as our overview, let me just kind of give you a sense of some framing remarks for what we're trying to accomplish with the study and also some of the highlights of what we thought about from the China angle, and then my colleagues will address each of their respective views in turn. I think it's fair to say that the course charted by China's reemergence as a great power over the next few decades certainly represents the primary strategic challenge for the East Asian security landscape. But to stay on the path that China is hoping to tread toward realizing this new global balance of power, the new leadership team under Xi Jinping will have to successfully navigate several challenges that they face both at home and abroad. They will have to prove that China's political and economic rise will be as sustainable over the next 30 years as it has been over the last third of a century, even though the task they are confronting now is much more complex than that faced by their predecessors. They will have to demonstrate sufficient foresight and flexibility to respond to immediate tactical concerns, a lot of what we've been seeing recently in the South China Sea, for example, while always staying very mindful of their geostrategic long game. They also, of course, will have to craft a workable strategic framework for channeling the country's growing wealth and power in a way that facilitates China's return to the dominant position in East Asia without sparking conflict with their neighbors or, more importantly, with the United States. And more fundamentally, they must answer the nagging question of what type of great power China wants to be in terms of whether or not to adhere to long-established global rules of the game that, of course, they had no hand in shaping. And I think a core element of our study was to take a look at President Xi Jinping's steady accretion of political power domestically. And I think that means that glimpses of the broad sweep of both his domestic and foreign policy strategies are coming into view more quickly and probably more sharply than other previous political power transitions might suggest. But obviously, it's still very early in his presumed decade-long tenure in power, and it would be foolish to suggest that we're seeing anything close to a complete picture of exactly where he may ultimately want to take the country. So with that, we just wanted to highlight a few of the key sort of foundational judgments that we came away from. The first, looking at the domestic political side, was a smooth, stable succession that took place in the fall of 2012 at the 18th Party Congress, despite some actually very serious turbulence inside the domestic politics of the Chinese system. The Bo Xilai case, of course, is the most prominent example, but also a situation where this generation of leaders was trying to orchestrate a power transition, the first one, that didn't have at least the ghostly touch of revolutionary elders of a previous period. And that was no small challenge. They had to be able to determine how to come up with new accords amongst themselves as to how to do this. And it's important as well to acknowledge that, at least so far, Xi Jinping and his new premier, Li Keqiang, seem to be working very smoothly together thus far. There's a lot of questions about Li Keqiang's standing in the system since Xi Jinping has grabbed a lot of titles for himself and a lot of authority for himself. But it's important, I think, to acknowledge that the two of them come from very different sort of groupings within the leadership, and there's no real reason to suggest that they should necessarily get along, which suggests to us that the sort of strong emphasis in the aftermath of the Tiananmen period on hanging together or hanging separately within the leadership remains very, very strong. But taking out from that smooth political transition to kind of Xi's rapid consolidation of power, we've discovered our key focus has been on sort of three keys that we've identified to Xi's rapid consolidation as domestic political strength. The first is this sort of princeling background of his, or his status as a child of one of the founders of the regime. And we assess that that gives him a unique understanding of the nature of power within the CCP system, especially how to wield power in that system, and the heavy emphasis we see coming out of him on the party as the main driver of moving forward with the whole reform program and launching China into this sort of new status as a great power. The second is that Xi Jinping appears to, through his actions, have acknowledged that in a Leninist system like China's, one must grab a hold of the key levers of power if you want to be able to successfully wield authority within the system. This is something that his predecessor, Hu Jintao, never really got around to doing, not for lack of desire, but rather because he was largely constrained by his own predecessor, Jiang Zemin. And so it's not, it should be no surprise to us then that Xi Jinping has moved very rapidly to take control of these key levers of power, the military, the security services, and the party bureaucracy. And that is allowing him to move much more quickly and adroitly, certainly than Hu Jintao was able to when he first came to power and arguably through most of his tenure. And then I think the final one is we've seen a very, what we're calling a defined political strategy of intimidation and coercion coming out of Xi Jinping, using a toolkit that is very coercive, three main prongs to that toolkit. The first one, of course, is the anti-corruption drive that we hear about on a daily basis, coming out of stories coming out about various people at various levels being detained. Obviously, he's looking to target some officials at a level that hasn't been done before. Certainly, he's bending, if not ready to break, depending on how it all comes out, some longstanding post-cultural revolution rules or norms about how leaders behave. And one of those, of course, was that you don't go after the children of leaders. And the other is that should one make it safely into retirement, all sins are forgiven with regard to corruption and so on. The second factor or tool in this toolkit is the deep ideological retrenchment that we've been seeing going on under Xi Jinping's tenure. And this has most publicly been seen, of course, in the crackdown on the internet, you know, various forms of the blogosphere, free speech, and so on. But even within the party itself, and some folks, even fairly powerful voices who are Xi Jinping's princeling brethren, if you will, but who hold more politically liberal views, have become very silent, whereas they were very active in previous years. So even they have gotten the message that one should not deviate to the right or to the left from where the line is coming down on the top. And we can talk more about that in the Q&A, but my sense is, of course, it's because they know how wrenching these changes are going to be that they're trying to pull off, and especially now in a context where the economy is clearly slowing much more quickly than they would have preferred. And then I think the third and final one is the return of these party rectification tools that really haven't been used in quite some time. You'll have to pardon the horrible jargon, but the mass line education campaign that Xi Jinping has been utilizing really is just a thinly veiled traditional party rectification campaign, where they're going around trying to dig up dirt on party cadres across the system, especially those who might be inclined to oppose what Xi Jinping is doing. So this sort of very pervasive and sort of stifling political retrenchment. So that's on the domestic political side. Then, of course, on the economic side, we have the third plenum and this very bold reform vision that came out of the third plenum last fall. And we particularly focused in the study on how this was looking at assigning this decisive role to the market. It's clearly the plenum's chief contribution to China's forward progression economically, but it's also its most controversial outcome because, of course, if they really do move toward assigning the market a decisive role in their economy, real vested interests within the system are going to lose real money. And I think that's what's real challenging now for this round of reform. In the 1980s, when Deng Xiaoping launched reform, once he was able to sweep away the remaining remnant Maoists, which really didn't take too much effort, there wasn't a lot of resistance to the reform program, primarily because the country was emerging from the collapse of the Cultural Revolution, and not too many people had much to lose. Fast forward to now, there's a lot of people who have a lot to lose in this system and don't want to see change. And so it was very interesting to me in that context then that Xi Jinping seemed to feel the need at the plenum last fall to justify this decision to upgrade the market status to a decisive role, from a basic role in the economy, as a theoretical achievement that the Central Committee had decided to do. And this is very significant because by suggesting that the reform program and this decision to increase the market's role is the party's line, effectively, in a theoretical context, it makes it a lot harder for the opponents to oppose. If it's a policy, you can object to it. If you're suggesting that the party's line is somehow wrong, you better win if you're going to make that charge, because that's a much more dangerous thing to do. And it also, of course, shows the depth of the opposition that we're seeing. And so how is the leadership responding to this challenge of this decisive role in the market? I think they're relying primarily on two tools. The first is, of course, the establishment of this new central leading group for comprehensively deepening reform, which, of course, is not just about economic reform, but also social reform, judicial reform, military reform. Pretty much every kind of reform you can think of was put together under the context of this leading group. And then the other, I think, really is pilots like the Shanghai Free Trade Zone, but not exclusive to the Shanghai Free Trade Zone, to be able to conduct some experimentation with regard to the goals that are laid out in the plenum document and then hope to expand those nationwide. But the question, of course, is, does Xi Jinping himself, having named himself the chair of no fewer than 8 or 9, I believe, of these leading groups, does he have the bandwidth to be able to manage this all on a day-to-day basis while he's also dealing with the foreign policy challenges and so on? And so in future work, we're going to try to take a more serious look, I think, at the people that he's putting in position to actually run these various reforms day-to-day, because obviously he's only one person. So if all of this, the domestic situation and the economic situation and Xi's rapid consolidation of political power was not much of a surprise, at least it wasn't to me. I'm not surprised to see him move so quickly. What was a surprise to us in the research? And I think it's that he's been doing all that domestically while also managing a very robust and fairly adroit foreign policy thus far. And it's a very different foreign policy program than we've seen under the previous leadership. Gone is pretty much any reference to Deng Xiaoping's longstanding adage that China should bide its time, hide its capabilities, keep a low profile on the international stage. Obviously, because of Deng Xiaoping's stature within the system, they'll never formally break with that phraseology. But I think if we look at the new leadership's approach to foreign policy, it's quite clear that that concept has been left behind. One need only look to the press conference that was given by Wang Yi, the foreign minister, at the National People's Congress in March, where when he was asked, as the first question of the press conference by a CCTV reporter, the foreign policy of the new leadership seems to be very outstanding. Can you tell us how outstanding it is? And he said in response that he described it as active, in a word, active. And this is something you would have never seen 5 years ago, a Chinese foreign minister or anyone else describing their foreign policy as active. And so to kind of get some theoretical underpinnings of why this shift in their foreign policy, we wanted to look at some key conceptual building blocks that we believe contribute to where we're going with this new construction. The first, of course, is the so-called period of strategic opportunity. This is a longstanding external strategic guideline. It's been validated by several party congresses. It's very authoritative within the Chinese system. And it's the notion that China has a sufficiently benign external security environment that they can focus on their internal development, and that at least through 2020, this will be the case. The new leadership has, just like its predecessors, validated that concept. But as we'll discuss later on, there are a few caveats to their endorsement of the period of strategic opportunity that suggest some of this different foreign policy. The second one we focused on was this concept of peaceful development, or the idea that not only will China's rise be peaceful and neighbors should not be concerned, but also they will emphasize win-win, win-win policies that will allow the neighborhood to prosper peacefully together. The third one, which is really, those two are long established, they've been around for a decade plus, but the third one is new, and it's this emphasis on the so-called two or twin centenary goals. And this emphasizes two very important anniversaries that are coming up for China. And it does also suggest to them, to us as observers, the long view that China takes in terms of how it thinks about these things. One, of course, is 2021, which is the 100th anniversary of the founding of the Chinese Communist Party. And the other is 2049, the 100th anniversary of the founding of the People's Republic of China. And very interestingly, if you look at most of the media commentary and other commentary in China about these two concepts, it has a heavy domestic focus. What this is about, of course, is these are strategic benchmarks that the leadership hopes to meet in order to legitimize itself and justify the Communist Party's continuing rule. And this is very different from a Western context. You know, in a US or European context, parties may come up with a political platform for a particular election, knowing full well that they won't implement 85 to 90% of it, probably. In this case, when the Chinese list these goals, sometimes they're a bit vague, but they do intend to meet them, again, as part of this legitimization process. So we should pay very close attention to these concepts. Very interestingly as well, it has been explicitly tied to the regime's foreign policy goal under the foreign policy approach under the new leadership. Yang Jiechi, the current state counselor and notionally the highest foreign policy official inside China's system, wrote an article in the party's chief theoretical magazine last August in which he indicated that promoting healthy and stable relations with the United States and other major diplomatic partners of China is the inherent requirement of the twin centennial goals and also also the inevitable demand for our overall strategy of peaceful development. So he's taking several of these categories, weaving them together, and tying them up in this twin centenary goals. And again, within the theoretical lexicon of the system, this is very, very important because what it does is create an unbreakable chain of authoritativeness of these various concepts. And so therefore, the twin centenary goals now are as valid in terms of their content as these other much more long-established ones. So those are kind of the key building blocks. Some of them have been around for a while, but what's new? And in our assessment, what's new is Xi Jinping's Chinese dream. And it's interesting the way in which State Councilor Yang, in this article that he wrote, tied all these other concepts into the Chinese dream. And the Chinese dream is actually an interesting formulation in that it's inevitable. It's very, very flexible. They can do anything they want with it. It's been rolled out sort of in a vague way. So it gives Xi Jinping a lot of maneuvering room as to how to define it. Frankly, it's also a lot more interesting than his predecessor's ideological contributions, such as the scientific development concept and the three represents. So certainly the Chinese dream has a lot more energy sounding to it, much more popular with folks. And so Xi Jinping has clearly set this out as his main theoretical achievement, and the foreign policy approach that they're going to undertake has the goal of achieving this Chinese dream. So what does this mean for relations with the neighbors and with the United States and everyone else? We looked at two kind of primary developments that seem to be coming out under the new leadership. The first, of course, is this development of a new type of great power relations with the United States, and interestingly, exclusively with the United States. And the official English translation in the system now is a new style of major country relations, but the Chinese hasn't changed. It's still great power relations. I think that was largely an English convenience to make it sound a little more palatable to some of the regional neighbors. It's a concept that is still being developed. Certainly the Chinese have sort of core principles that they've designed around the concept, but the content is something that is still open to question. And I think there's kind of two views in our research that emerged on how to describe this concept. The more benign view of it, I think, is that it's something somewhat akin to détente with the Soviet Union in the 1970s, by which there's something called the U.S.-China relationship, which has to be put on a plane above the frequent friction that we will have in the bilateral relationship that's natural in a situation where you have a rising power meeting an established power on the world stage. And that managing those frictions is important to ensuring that that doesn't tip over into a conflict. I think we've seen some elements of this definition or this assessment of the approach, especially in the much more positive tone in U.S.-China military-to-military relations since the new leadership has come into power, and especially greater emphasis on strategic stability in that relationship after a period where that was not the case. So what does this mean, though? Oh, excuse me. And so the second variety, I suppose, is a little bit darker picture, which is that the idea that the Chinese are looking through this concept to get Washington to acquiesce on a series of major planks in their platform that they would like to see happen. And of course, this is mutual recognition of the political systems, primarily China's domestic political system, some recognition from the United States of the concept of core interests, which would include territorial concessions, and a role for Chinese in shaping, you know, new global regimes and norms. And as I said, I think there's elements of both pieces of this puzzle in what we've seen so far, and I think that's because the leadership is still working its way through exactly how they want to define this, and they're looking for some cueing from the United States as to how to understand it. So what does it mean for everybody else in the region? If the U.S. gets new type of great power relations, what does everyone else get? In our research, we've kind of come across the idea that it's this sort of great power diplomacy is the language that we saw very early in Xi Jinping's tenure. As he embarked on his maiden trip to Russia, there was a People's Daily article, very prominent, describing this concept. And it's an interesting concept because the terminology actually is old. Jiang Zemin first came up with this concept during his tenure in the late 1990s. The interesting difference is that at that time, the concept was that China should be attempting to assert itself as a great power where it could, but under an acknowledgement of the umbrella of U.S. hyperpower, right? So the idea that while acknowledging the U.S.'s dominant role, China would try to assert itself as a great power. In the new version that's coming out under Xi Jinping, I think the view is that the U.S. and China are much more equals in the relationship. There's not this willingness to concede to U.S. hyperpower in this great power diplomacy formulation that's come out. And what does it mean for the regional neighbors? It means basically that China should exercise its newfound strength and rise as a traditional great power in the region, which of course means that they are seeking the dominant position in the region, and they want all others to recognize that and to be able to understand that China will, they want the other countries in the region, when they're thinking about taking a particular decision, to think about what China thinks about it, at least as quickly as they think about what the United States thinks about it, or perhaps before they think about what the United States thinks about it. And this doesn't mean that this concept isn't going to be peaceful, and it's possible for us to work out a very sort of integrated new security structure. President Xi has talked about this in his recent comments at the SICA summit in Shanghai. We'll have to see how this is developed. But, of course, a lot of the other regional players, as my colleagues will discuss, are concerned about what this sort of great power diplomacy concept might mean. I'm going to go ahead and stop there and ask Matt to chime in, and we'll take it from there. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Chris. Let me add my thanks to the Sasakawa Peace Foundation for making this event possible, and thanks to all of you for coming. It's great to see such a large and, I'm sure, soon lively crowd. So I'm just going to make a couple of points about economic diplomacy and that how that fits into this story. Just a couple of points. So first point is that China's foreign economic strategy or its international economic policy has really been a function of its preoccupation with domestic development and growth. And so in a sense, even when they have engaged in international economic affairs, since the reform and opening period launched by Deng Xiaoping, the focus on international economics has been on, bringing foreign direct investment into China to promote internal development, or bringing resources into China to support development, or to create stable markets for China to sell into. And so I think the key point there is that the lens through which they've pursued international economic and regional economic affairs is through domestic development. And this has sometimes had unintended consequences. For example, when Jiang Zemin pushed out or encouraged SOEs to go out, the going out strategy in 2002, and companies went out to in search of resources, this often had both economic and foreign policy consequences for China that weren't what was originally intended, including the fact that they overpaid for resources and had to sell them at a discount, or created local problems ranging from concern that China's approach was self-serving to actual, concerns about sort of neo-colonialism and along the way environmental degradation and so forth. So this focus on domestic development as the driver has sometimes caused them trouble. So that's, I think, the first set of points. The second is that there have been bursts of more proactive diplomacy along the way, and the one that's often cited is following the Asian financial crisis in 1997, or during the financial crisis in 1997, when China used a combination of policy restraint, not devaluing the RMB, providing financial support, and calling for sort of Asian solidarity. Admittedly, some of this was driven by other factors, like China didn't want to promote inflation at home, so it didn't devalue, rather than, in order to necessarily win friends and influence people. But that was clearly a part of this. And so I think that's an example where they've been more proactive in a kind of more positive way. There are also examples where the proactive diplomacy has been a little bit more less positive or more sinister. For example, the case in 2010 when China temporarily cut off supplies of rare earths to Japan in the wake of the nationalization of the purchase of the Senkaku Diaoyu Islands, so that's an example, or the Philippine banana case where they banned shipments of Philippine bananas in relation to the Scarborough Shoal challenge. Even when China has done things, again, in this burst of these bursts of proactive diplomacy that are more positive, they've had unintended consequences. So, for example, the support that they gave to Cambodia in 2012, providing financing and so forth, ultimately helped to win a tactical victory at the subsequent ASEAN meetings, where they got Cambodia to not issue the full communique coming out from that summit. But that ended up having consequences, because ASEAN later then issued a statement about, you know, with six principles about the South China Sea, which so was a reaction to this. So sometimes this has had a consequence of backfiring. So my third set of points is about looking for sort of signs of more systematic and strategic dimensions to their international economic or regional economic policies. Obviously, economics has been a part of their smile diplomacy in the region for a long time. But I would again say, post 97, after this sort of more opportunistic period, you saw early on Zhu Rongji, for example, proposing an ASEAN FTA, and eventually, although again, I think it was really Japan that drove the original ASEAN plus three idea, that is ASEAN plus China, Japan, Korea. China eventually latched on to that and saw that as an opportunity to build a more Sino-centric architecture, or certainly more Asian-centric, without the United States as part of this. Personal story, and I told a story from APEC yesterday, so I apologize if I keep telling APEC stories, but in 2003, when I was working on APEC at the White House and went to Bangkok to help pre-negotiate the communique, I was struck by how effective Chinese diplomats were in working the APEC room, including giving the Philippines track changes to one of the communique drafts, which the Philippines submitted to Thailand as the host. And when I saw that the Philippines' comments were identical to the Chinese, that was very striking to me, that, you know, particularly the Philippines of all places. So there's been a systematic attempt to try to be more strategic and more engaged in some of these regional economic endeavors. But skipping, you know, to more recent times, and Xi Jinping, as Chris said, as part of the China dream and some of the other new trends that he mentioned, clearly there has been a focus on establishing a kind of Sino-centric economic order in the region, and you know, Xi Jinping and Li Keqiang, between them, for example, have been to all 10 of the ASEAN countries already. In fact, within the first year, they had, I think, been to all of them, and offering a lot of economic incentives and trying to work the crowd there. So this sort of, as part of this peripheral diplomacy, economics has been a very important part of the story. Xi Jinping himself has endorsed this idea of ASEAN connectivity. I think Ernie Mabel will talk about some of these themes a little bit later, but that's been a central part of the effort to be a little more systematic and strategic about engagement with the rest of the region. China's announced this infrastructure bank, which is still, the details of which are a little vague, but potentially sizable amounts of money behind infrastructure, which everyone in the region agrees is needed and valued. I think the challenges in sort of their rolling out a more systematic regional economic policy are, first of all, that a lot of these efforts to date have still been somewhat haphazard and have reflected to some extent the broader challenges of coordination of policy in China. You know, you have many different actors, SOEs and local governments and different ministries all participating in this activity in one way or the other, and it isn't always very well coordinated. Another problem for China is just it's big. So the fact that it's so big, it sometimes creates a sense of, from the perspective of other countries, this sort of large economic force that people are a little reluctant to be fully pulled into, even though they are, of course, for their own economic interest, want to be engaged more deeply with China. There's also a sense that somehow China is a threat just by its size. And then some of the policies that, China has pursued have been seen, I think, again, as, somewhat narrow and self-serving. I think that's been a challenge for China to overcome. And then, of course, the relationship of security and economic issues and, the concerns about China's more assertive posture on other issues, as it were, I think has hampered their ability to, roll out this this more positive and strategic economic diplomacy. So I think I'll just stop there and go on down the line.
Great, thank you. So I too want to begin by thanking the Saskow Peace Foundation for their support of this project, this research. I want to thank Chris for heading up the team and shepherding us through this project. I think the publication you have in front of you is quite good, from both a policy and also an academic perspective. My piece of this was to be one of the looks at the regional picture, and in particular the Korean Peninsula and their relationship with China. And so I too want to begin with a story, which was that when I was in the U.S. government at the White House working on Asia stuff, one of my accounts was Korea, and at the time there was a South Korean president who was, how should we put it, slightly to the left of center. And he had come up with this term for the Korea's relationships with the big powers in Asia, which was something that was known as the balancer principle, right? And the idea being that Korea would sort of hover and gravitate above the raw balance of power politics in the region and would take sides depending on the issue, you know, between the United States and China. This was naturally very disconcerting for us who were the alliance managers, because we thought we had a relationship, we had an alliance with South Korea. But then it was only further confirmed in a couple of meetings that we did with China as part of the U.S.-China, what was it called then?
Strategic
Economic Dialogue, or the Senior Dialogue, one of those
that
two.
That was the State Department,
yeah,
right?
Right. The State. It was the State Department one.
Sorry, Senior Dialogue.
And we talk about the region, and China would then start talking about Southeast Asia, Japan, Australia, every part of the region except the Korean Peninsula. And we thought that was strange. Why don't they talk about the Korean Peninsula? And it was pretty obvious that the reason they didn't was because they thought that was theirs. There was, this was not in the balance, right? This was something that eventually would come to them. And so, you know, this has led to a lot of academic writing, policy writing about the whole question of where Korea stands. And if you sort of did a bibliographic search of the titles for these sorts of articles, they would all say this, they would all give the same metaphor, sort of something that's on a scale, right? So is it anchored or is it adrift, right? Where does it, is the scale tipping, to the east or to the west? Is it tipping towards the continent or towards the maritime? These were always the titles that were used to sort of describe where Korea stood in the bigger grand strategic picture. And in a sense, you know, the implicit suggestion was that, you know, of this fabled and grand U.S. alliance network in Asia, this was the weakest link, right? In many ways, that this was the weakest link. Unlike Japan, where things were pretty cut and dry in terms of where Japan and the United States stood on issues, with Korea, it was less so. And so, so using that as a template, what I really wanted to look at was this question of to what extent Korea really is anchored in the alliance network in the long term, or is it eventually adrift? And I think in general the answer is, at least my personal opinion, is that it is anchored. It's very much anchored in the West and the U.S. alliance. We just did a rollout last week of the CSIS Survey of Strategic Elites that had a number of questions, but one of them was a question on U.S. leadership in Asia and your support of it. With the continued existence of U.S. capabilities, or even in the face of declining U.S. capabilities. And the country that registered the highest in terms of strongly supporting continued U.S. leadership with or without capabilities was South Korea. It was actually even higher than the United States in terms of the polling. At the SICA meeting that Chris or Matt mentioned, Korea was the country that was the one that said they would not sign on to the effort to create a statement about the sort of anachronism of bilateral security alliances in Asia. Korea is deeply embedded in the economic architecture of the region. It is conducting free trade talks with China, but at the same time, very consciously came out and said it's in support of TPP and wishes to join TPP at some point, with less of an enthusiastic response to things like RCEP. So, and I think in many ways, the current president of South Korea, Park Geun-hye, although she is very interested in growing the strategic relationship with China for reasons I'll talk about in a minute, is very clear that the core of U.S. South Korean foreign policy is the alliance relationship with the United States. Now, having said all that, it's undeniable that it is a very it's a much more complex picture for Korea. I think much more so than Japan. You know, the Japan-China relationship is defined as sort of a great power, peer competitor relationship. But in Korea, I think it's a much more complex relationship. And so I spent a good part of the paper explaining why it's complex. I think for the purposes of today, I'll just focus on sort of three basic dilemmas. I mean, the first is that, you know, Korea lives in the neighborhood as a medium-sized power that will always, forever and ever have China as a neighbor. Never going to go away. It's a basic geopolitical reality. At the same time, it is the one country in the region that has China as a neighbor that is sort of an open political, so a very different value system, right? And so that's never going to change. So on the one hand, they need to get along with their neighbor. On the other hand, there's clearly a gap in sort of the political values and the belief systems of the two countries. Second dilemma is Korea, when they polled in the CSIS Strategic Elite Survey, saw China hands down as the most important economic partner for Korea for the next generation, right? Undeniably. But at the same time, they understand that economic reality with China, but at the same time, they don't see their strategic future with China. Again, when they're polled in the CSIS Strategic Elite Survey, Koreans very strongly said that their most important strategic partner and political partner in the future for the next decade or so, 25 years, was still the United States. So that's another source of tension. And then the third, of course, is something that's very close to Koreans, and that is the whole question of unification. The dilemma here is that Korea needs China in any possible scenario involving unification, but at the same so it needs to draw closer to China for that purpose, but at the same time, there's an understanding that China doesn't want North Korea to collapse. Right? It wants to sort of maintain this buffer there for as long as they can. So because of these dilemmas, I think the Korea relationship with China looks much more complex, is much more complex, and maybe there are things that ring true also with Southeast Asia as well, but certainly in Northeast Asia, I think it is probably got the most complex relationship. Let me very quickly just talk about today. So China will be coming to South Korea. There's a summit coming up between the two leaders, Xi Jinping and Park Geun-hye, sometime this month. It will be the second summit between the two leaders. Xi Jinping has some sort of high school crush on Park Geun-hye. I mean, it's very clear that he likes her. He gets very nervous around her. He starts sweating, starts playing with his tie. And I don't know if you say that on TV, but so there's a very good relationship there. And the Koreans are really working very hard, I think, to deepen that strategic relationship. They're trying to start an NSC dialogue with the new NSC in Beijing. They're trying to deepen defense ties, obviously foreign ministry ties. They're working very hard at this. Now, the one interpretation that I've heard quite often in Washington is that the reason that the South Koreans are interested in this is because, again, they're tilting. They're tilting back towards the continent, away from the traditional maritime alliance coalition in Asia, and also because they're pissed off with the Japanese. Right? You hear this quite often. And I just don't think that's right. I mean, it is absolutely right that the Koreans are pissed off with the Japanese. That's for sure. But what is drawing them to China, I think, is a feeling, is a sense, is an instinct that China's position on North Korea is starting to waver. It's not 100%, you know, North Korea forever, lips and teeth, all this sort of stuff. There's clearly disenchantment with the leadership in North Korea. You don't have the same influential policymakers inside the Chinese system who have traditionally been apologists for North Korea. North Korean behavior continues to be very unpredictable, including, as we all know, the execution of Chang Sung-taek, who was very important to the Chinese in North Korea. So I think there's a sense, not that the Chinese are ready to defect from their relationship with North Korea, but it's a little bit wobbly. And so for that reason, I think the South Koreans are going in, leveraging the very good relationship that Park Geun-hye has with Xi Jinping, and really wants to try to at least move the needle a little bit. And that's why I think we see the deep engagement. The Japan thing, and that's a separate issue. But I see this more as an opportunity that the South Koreans are trying to take advantage of with China, rather than something that is a reflection of a disenchantment with the alliance system or with Japan in particular. So.
Thanks, Victor. And thanks, too, I see Dan Bob out there. Thank you to the Sasakawa Peace Foundation for their support for this research. And thanks to Chris for keeping these cats in the corral. Not easy. You know, Southeast Asia also has a lot of the same concerns that Victor mentioned about Korea. I think the key thing for them was to see what a China under Xi would look like. And as we wrote this report, the outlines of that were starting to take shape. After we wrote the report, the Chinese towed the oil rig 981, the Haiyang oil rig off the coast of Vietnam. And I think we can see that, actually, I reread the report, you know, to get ready for this, and I thought we sort of nailed it, you know. Southeast Asia doesn't know, and this drives them crazy, what China wants to be. What is the new China? And they're trying to understand that. I think they watched very carefully what Xi is about. I think they're starting to get the picture. As Chris mentioned, China is sort of completing its story. It's 2049 date is the one that has Southeast Asia's attention. Because it looks to Southeast Asia like China has sort of taken off the gloves and is not going to, the charm rhetoric is still there. But the actions speak louder than words. And unfortunately, the actions are scaring the hell out of Southeast Asia, to be honest with you. So I think all 10 members of ASEAN are asking the same questions. No one really believes they have the answers yet, or if the answers, as the answers start to take shape, they wish they weren't the answers that they're seeing. So divining Xi Jinping, China's foreign policy intentions in general, and Xi's in specific, are a policy priority within ASEAN. And I think it's important for the United States to understand the other side of that coin is a preoccupation in Southeast Asia with understanding what the intentions and capabilities of the United States are. This is very important because ASEAN, like Korea in some ways, but in some ways I think even more so, are balancers. They're seeking balance. So, you know, I think when ASEAN understands that the United States is not trying to contain China, but they also understand that, that China uses the containment argument as code for don't get too close to the United States or we'll use our strategic toolbox against you. And I think we're starting to see some of that come into play. I touched on a couple of things. I thought I'd talk about a couple of things. I think ASEAN sees the following points. She is in charge. Like Chris mentioned, there's no question anymore whether a decisive power or a decisive leader in Beijing is aware of what's happening in the South China Sea, whether it's the maritime Coast Guard authorities or even a, sort of a rogue PLA or PLAN that's taking actions in the South China Sea. I think Haiyang and Vietnam proved that to ASEAN, particularly because the Chinese decided to do this, towed a billion-dollar rig into the Vietnamese waters just a week before the ASEAN ministers were meeting, the ASEAN summit in Myanmar. So there's no question. I think ASEAN believes they see a decisive and powerful leader in Beijing, and that's something that they're focused on. They also see Xi as a strong nationalist. They believe he's a nationalist who will put China's interests, including its priorities, regarding its own definition of its sovereignty, above all other considerations. So I think we're seeing a China foreign policy in Southeast Asia that basically is focused on China's domestic goals. And if the ASEANs are going to have a hard time understanding that this is the way it's going to be, so be it. This is really concerning because rhetoric from China in diplomatic structures are not consistent with its actions. And that's really rattling Southeast Asia. I think the region believes that China intends to aggressively push its advantage in the South China Sea. There's an optimistic view. There's always optimism in Southeast Asia, for those of you who know the region. There's always hope. And the optimistic view of Xi is that his leadership is an opportunity, that when he consolidates power, he'll use that power to reform and strengthen China's economy, enhance his personal control over a military that was the leading edge of the efforts in the South China Sea, and that he would focus on working with the neighbors rather than challenging them or controlling them. I think we're pretty much done with the optimistic view there. I mean, I wrote this before Vietnam, and I think that's starting to really wither. The other view is that Xi is a threat. I think it's a more realistic and pervasive concern among ASEAN countries. A Xi wielding real power could mean a more assertive Chinese foreign policy, especially, and this is really important for American strategy and policymakers, especially if Beijing perceives weakness and relative inattention in Washington. And guess what, folks? They do. I think that perception, the factors facing shaping Southeast Asia security perceptions are very much based on this perception of weakness in Washington. An inconsistency, I think we've talked a lot about it. They see an inconsistency here. They see a divided, a Washington divided by partisan ideology, not driving towards national interests. They see real questions about the course of history, U.S. isolationism after foreign wars. And I think what's most important in Asia, when you talk about security, is economics. Economics is the very foundation of the concept of security in Southeast Asia. And most ASEAN countries are concerned that China will use its growing economic power to drive its sovereign agenda. They can understand that. While China is not a large investor in ASEAN yet, its capital flows from Chinese entities into Southeast Asia are growing, As you know, it's the number one or number two trading partner with most of the ASEAN countries. That's been a good story for Southeast Asia for the most part, and it should continue to be a good growth story if China is not going to use that economic leverage to assert its sovereign concerns. But as Matt mentioned, that's not the story. We've seen the economic levers used in Japan. We've seen them used in the Philippines. And that is a veiled, it's a semi-veiled threat that's being used more often as we go forward. I think ASEAN is concerned that China may see the benefits of a weak ASEAN. They believe China may not want to see a strong and integrated ASEAN because the Chinese, if their goals are, as we found in this study, to assert their position, they would much rather work on the ASEAN countries where there are disputes in a bilateral way rather than with ASEAN. And although there's rhetoric towards completing a code of conduct for the South China Sea, in reality, that code of conduct, a binding code of conduct, keeps getting kicked down the road. There's a sense in Southeast Asia that China tolerates regional architecture, but it puts its real eggs in the bilateral basket. Very specifically, China's, as I mentioned, would rather negotiate bilaterally with the ASEAN countries than in a code of conduct with ASEAN. And in terms of economic integration in Asia, China very much would like to see China or the ASEAN plus three format, which China has tended to dominate, instead of some of the regional economic architecture that we've looked at, in such as TPP or APEC. And that may change. I hope it does. But so far, it's not good. And I think for the U.S., I think we have to understand we've got to get our heads in the game in terms of convincing all of Asia, China, ASEAN, Korea, that there's a political foundation for long-term American engagement in Asia, and that we're going to lead economic with economic engagement and state clearly that we understand that's the basis for security in Asia. Thanks.
Thank you. I'd also like to thank Sasakawa Peace Foundation and Chris for leading this effort. I'm going to briefly summarize 5 points that are made at the end of the report, what are listed as possible lessons for the U.S.-Japan alliance as we consider the implications of China's rise. I think the first, based on some of the comments you've heard already, is that it's important for the United States and Japan to continually share regional assessments. Not all countries in the region view Chinese power the same way, and there may be domestic considerations that motivate China policy throughout the region. And it's very important for the U.S.-Japan alliance to move forward to have a solid understanding of what those views are. And I think trilateral dialogues with countries such as Australia, India, and others are really important in reaching a better understanding of how the region as a whole views these developments in China, which are extremely complex and automatically invite different views and perspectives. So I think having a better understanding of regional assessments of Chinese powers is extremely important for the U.S.-Japan alliance. The second, which Chris referenced earlier and which is articulated in the report, is that we really can't predict whether China is going to be a full cooperative stakeholder in the international system, or at the other end of the spectrum, a strategic rival. So for the U.S.-Japan alliance, it's important to come up with a strategy that combines deterrence, dissuasion, but also reassurance. We have very strong bilateral defense coordination mechanisms in place. There's a so-called 2+2. The U.S. and Japanese governments are currently reviewing bilateral guidelines for defense cooperation. The deterrence and dissuasion component is quite clear. But there could be more room to explore reassurance. And the reality is that the neighbors of China in the region don't want to have to choose between the United States and China. And the U.S., Japan, and other countries in the region have a stake in China's economic development and political evolution. So as we consider the way forward, it's important to look for opportunities for engagement and to encourage China to participate in confidence building and transparency measures. Third point is coordination at regional forums and multilateral institutions in the region. I think the U.S., Japan, and other partners in the region have a role in making sure that these forums reinforce international rules and norms and are places where coercive tools are not accepted. And I think we'll see this trend going forward. Fourth area for the alliance is capacity building. Issues such as maritime domain awareness or disaster response or disaster risk reduction. I think the Philippines comes to mind. There's great potential for joint training that involves the U.S., Japan, and the Philippines in a capacity building context. And finally, linked to the capacity building issue is perhaps room to better align U.S. and Japanese development strategies in the region, particularly in Southeast Asia. When Vice President Biden visited Japan last December, the two governments issued a long fact sheet on global cooperation, of which development was a very key component. And earlier this year, in February, the U.S. and Japan started a senior-level development dialogue. And Southeast Asia features heavily in that, and I think there's potentially room to better align the development agenda between the U.S. and Japan, again, to reinforce rules and norms. And Victor referenced our survey of regional elites earlier. Just one parenthetical note, and then I'll conclude. I found it particularly interesting that China was the only country where a majority of respondents felt that the U.S. rebalance to the region was too confrontational toward China. But we also asked a question about what experts thought was in their country's best interests in terms of future order in Asia. And among the Chinese respondents, there was no consensus. Whether it was U.S. leadership or Chinese primacy or U.S.-China great power relations or a community of multilateral institutions that manage the economic evolution and the security and stability in the region. So my personal view is that China might not like the U.S. presence and the U.S. rebalance, but I'm not really sure what vision China is articulating for the future, and we're just going to have to monitor that very closely. So thank you very much.
Okay, thanks to all my colleagues, and certainly a lot for folks to chew on in there. And we'd like to open up the floor to questions. As per usual CSIS practice, if you would please identify yourself and where you come from, and then also please do confine your question to a brief question that is indeed a question. First up. Yeah, right here in the front. Please wait for the microphone.
Should I stand up? I'm Andre Sauvageau, and I'm the chief representative in Vietnam for a company in Detroit, the Interstate Traveler Company, but I do business for different companies in Vietnam. Now, so my question is this. I go back to Chris' statement of the two views of Chinese foreign policy, the benign and the darker. And you expressed them both so well, and leads to the question. And that is, I think, leading from Ernie's discussion of the realities of action speaking louder than words, and you even used correct language instead of euphemism. You talked about dragging the oil rig into Vietnamese territorial waters instead of disputed waters. So that's a refreshing start. So the question is this. What will it take to, what does the United States need to do, and other countries, but basically the United States, to change the balance Ernie or anybody, to make it better, a better prognosis by maybe speaking more clearly about realities and other things. What do they need to do? And to diminish Beijing's perception that the United States is what in fact it is, distracted and not paying so much attention to this.
Well, I think first of all we have to. I think Nick talked about it. I think we should reassure China. We can't succeed in Asia without China being secure, feeling powerful. I don't think any structure in Asia, any regional economic or security structure, could work if it excludes China. And so, let's be clear about that. We need a safe and secure China, one that's productive and feels like it's part of making the rules and then implementing those rules. But I think to do so, we have to dissuade Asia and China specifically that the United States is somehow distracted, that the pivot to Asia or the rebalancing is some sort of a near-term slogan or rhetoric. And I think if you look at reality, the first thing is research. Research shows, and I think we've done a lot of it here, that the United States is never leaving Asia. We are deeply invested there. We are part of it from an economic point of view. From a security point of view, Asia is very critical to our country. But what we need, I think, Andre, is a leader who is willing to talk to Americans and this modern political rhetoric be damned. Somebody's got to talk to Americans about why the United States has got to be involved in Asia, why it's our jobs are dependent on Asia, our security is dependent on Asia. And even if they're foreign policy advisors who get them, or not their foreign policy, their political, domestic political advisors who get them elected, say, look, don't say Asia, don't say foreign policy, and don't say trade. You know, these are not things that'll get you elected. I think it's a real test of leadership to say, you know what, guys, I'm sorry, but if I can't get elected telling the truth about what's important to our country, I don't want this job. And I think that's what we need, to be honest with you.
I think another key factor there is arresting the deterioration in Sino-U.S. bilateral ties. We've seen some very challenging moments here recently, and my sense just coming back from China recently is that to some degree the Chinese are very confused about what the U.S. approach to the relationship is. I think President Xi feels that President Obama is not engaged on the relationship, that indeed he may not even be in control of his own system. From their perspective, when cyber indictments, these sort of things that seem so contrary to what the two presidents themselves have discussed, come out of our system. I think the other piece here is Ernie mentioned about economics being security in Asia. We're allowing right now, it seems, those difficult security issues that are natural when a rising power meets an established power, the rub, if you will, in the relationship, to dominate the relationship when, as President Xi said when he was vice president and came and visited, it's the economic relationship. He called it the ballast and the propeller. I use a slightly different word. I say shock absorber, but the idea is the same. That's why we don't have a Cold War relationship with China. We're 3 weeks away from the strategic and economic dialogue. The Chinese perception is that there's no U.S. agenda for that, you know, sort of major meeting. There's a real opportunity, top officials meeting, to recalibrate the relationship. So I think the Chinese are very confused, and as Ernie sort of suggested, could use some reassurance from the U.S. side that they are indeed invested in the relationship and want to have that very top-level integration between their two leaders. Gentleman in the dark suit.
Well, I don't want to, there's a lady in a dark suit here too, so I don't want to take the mic away from her. But maybe just a quick comment and a question. David Sedney, formerly of the State and Defense Departments. The comment, Chris, is I'm a little concerned about perhaps dismissing the party rectification campaign as just another one, because there's a big history of these. It could be a 100 flowers kind of thing, or it could be a Hu Jintao scientific development kind of thing. And I think we have to wait and see just how important that will be in China. So I would just urge that as a caution. Secondly, for everybody in the panel, really, who wants to comment, One country that didn't seem to get mentioned very much, unless I missed it, was India. And we have the election of a new leader in India who seems to be very intent upon reaching out to Japan to create a very strong alliance with Japan. How does that play into this decoding of China, and how is this new India, potentially new India, going to be perceived by China as India is also rising? But the lady here did have a question also. I don't know if you want to take both of ours or...
Sorry? Didn't catch the back part there.
The lady here did have a question.
Oh, yeah, sure. Go ahead.
You can take both of ours.
Thank you for that. I'm Lara Parvin-Smith from USAID Office of Donor Engagement. And I think it was Mr. Goodman who brought up the Chinese Infrastructure Bank. And I was wondering if you had a bit more detail as to the status of the creation and how you, and I'd be interested to hear from the other panelists, too, how it may influence the region. Thanks.
Great. Let me just start with the India question with just a structural thing. When we were constructing the study, we had to make some choices. And so we sort of decided to focus on China's front door, if you will, the maritime side of things. Because if we had included India, then we would have had to include Russia and Central. It got very complicated very quickly, I think. But you make a great point, David. I think that with Modi's election and very interesting stuff going on between the Chinese and Modi so far already, very, very interesting, especially given Modi's, my understanding of Modi's past approach toward China. It's interesting that the Chinese appear to be trying to reach out to him early on. Obviously, as we mentioned at the beginning, we're very fortunate. Our good friends at the Sasakawa Peace Foundation have agreed to allow us to continue this research going forward as the commission continues its meetings, and so I'm sure we'll do something on India at that point. I don't know if anybody else wants to throw in any comments on India, but...
I would just say on India, Modi looks like a really interesting opportunity. He's a practical guy, a decisive guy, a business-oriented focus. He's got a mandate in India, and the Chinese were there a couple days ago, and they said, we're going to invest more in India. We want to work more with you economically, and we will minimize our political and security issues. So this is an opportunity for the Chinese to sort of change the pattern, right? They should engage economically. I think Modi will be very interested in that. But if that comes at the same time with, border crossings in the Northeast, I think we'll see a bad pattern. And I think the Indians will back off because they'll see the same things that the Southeast Asians have seen. But let's look at Modi as leading India as an opportunity for China. And I think certainly Southeast Asia and the Americans would hopefully see it that way.
I just add a brief point. I'd encourage you to take a look at the event we had earlier this week run by our India chair, Rick Rosso, on a new book that has come out looking at the experience of Chinese companies in India and Indian companies in China. It really gets at a lot of the questions there. Let me ask Matt, since the question was addressed to him, to jump in on that, but I'm sure Ernie has a view on the ASEAN Infrastructure Bank piece as well.
Yeah, I'm afraid I don't have a lot of detail. I'm not sure there is a lot of detail yet. The Chinese, I think President Xi mentioned this initiative in one of his trips to Southeast Asia, and it's now been sort of part of the conversation in a number of forums in Asia. But the details and the modalities and, how much money and where it's going to go and what kinds of disciplines might be attached to the money is still unclear. There have been some concerns about whether so the positive thing is that I think, again, as I think I said in passing, everybody understands that there is a crying need for greater infrastructure across all of Asia, and by the way, in the United States and other advanced countries who are part of the Asia-Pacific region. And so I think the fact that China is willing to use some of its economic and financial power to help invest and address this challenge is broadly welcome. I think the concerns that have been raised are about sort of, again, what sorts of, what the conditions might be applied to that money, and whether that set of disciplines will be consistent with what the Asian Development Bank and other existing institutions in the region that are engaged in this kind of financing use as conditionality for this lending. And so I think these questions are out there, but it hasn't been, as far as I know, there hasn't been a master plan or a detailed set of proposals for this institution yet.
Yeah, I would just emphasize from my own perspective watching the China piece as well, that there's not a lot of detail. We're still waiting. I think Ernie's decided to take a pass so we can get some more questions in. So next question, the gentleman over here in the corner.
My name is Kunio Kikuchi, and sorry, I'm with Washington Research and Analysis, formerly of the World Bank. I'm glad India was brought up because they just elected the president, where he was chosen with 500 million votes. If I were to think in terms of China as a huge rock, Russia is about one-tenth. Japan is also a little less than one-tenth. Korea is only one-twentieth the size of this gigantic rock. And I'm wondering how firm the rock is in terms of governance and continuity, in the sense that if there are cracks, and I don't mean cracks by military or ethnicity, but the people's demand for more information and transparency in government, how long do you think the current form of single-party dictatorship in China is sustainable, say, going forward 10 years, 15 years? Thank you.
I'm guessing that one's for me. Okay. You know, obviously, this is a chief preoccupation of the new leadership team. And I think what we're seeing is Xi Jinping's definition of how you go about making those governance changes that you've suggested. If you look at the document that was approved by the plenum, there's a lot of very interesting developments in there that will, over time, constrain the role that the party is playing in the system. You know, if they, again, coming back to this initial point about assigning a decisive role to the market, if that is successful, then the state, of course, must step back in terms of its control of the economy. Interestingly, Xi Jinping, again, in this sort of theoretical space, and this is something that's very interesting about him as a leader so far, is he seems to have a strong interest, if not a need, to wrap up a lot of what he's doing in these ideological terms. It's a big difference, really, from some of his predecessors. And he's talked very recently, as you know, when Deng Xiaoping launched the reform program, there were four modernizations. And now there's talk of a fifth modernization, which is exactly governance and improving the responsiveness of the system, improving the way the system reacts to stimulus, getting out of the sort of stovepipe nature that they have now, because they realize that they have a fairly stovepiped, almost rickety Leninist system riding atop a very dynamic society, right? And that is not a good solution. So I think we got to watch very carefully, but give them time, because this is not going to be easy. But I think Xi Jinping is determined to make some serious change that may even look at a fundamental reshaping of the party state. The other point I would make is it is abundantly clear that Xi Jinping is not China's Gorbachev. You know, this guy has no interest in overturning party rule. In fact, he wants to strengthen it, so that's important to keep in mind as well. Let's go here.
Thank you. My name is Gun Gumilar. I'm from Indonesia. I'm a student at Harvard University. So my question is, right now Indonesia is in the political issue of the general elections, which is Prabowo Subianto, Joyo Hadikusumo, and Joko Widodo. So I would like to know about the how's your response to economic impact after the elections of to especially to Asia Pacific trade area, especially to Indonesia. Thank you.
I'm going to have you answer that, but I'd like to throw something in first, if I might. Not specific to your question, but I think this is one of those areas, you know, there's a lot of debate, and we confronted this in the study, I think, about China seemingly, with some of these actions, doing things that are counterproductive, right, or things that don't seem to be in their interest. And in having conversations there, I think there is a suggestion that one of the reasons why they feel confident that they can do what they've been doing is that the U.S., as Ernie mentioned, with economics being security in the region, is not providing an appropriate counterbalance, and therefore the sucking sound, if you will, of China's rise in economy is so powerful. And that the region then will accept this behavior because of that economic leverage. When having this discussion, I did ask them to think about Indonesia in this context, because I think that we are seeing some signs of concern from the Indonesians. I'll let Ernie elaborate about what's going on. But here's a country, in my estimation, who should be feeling very good about its relations with China, and yet because of some of these recent actions is having some questions. And Indonesia, because of its size and its growth and so on, they can be the ringleader of ASEAN. ASEAN needs a ringleader to be effective. And I don't know much about Jokowi, but my sense is he's a bit of a blank slate in terms of foreign policy. And so there will be an opportunity there for multiple parties to shape his views.
I think Indonesia is at an exciting juncture right now with the presidential elections coming up on July 9th. And I think if you look at the survey we did of ASEAN elites that we published last week, Indonesia was, very, very much focused on the benefits of China being a strong trading partner. But they also they haven't had a good experience with the ASEAN-China FTA. And I think Indonesia wishes that it could back out of that agreement. In fact, Gita Wirawan and other Indonesian trade ministers under SBY have sort of pushed back hard, Marie Pangestu and others, on the ASEAN-China FTA and what they thought was sort of abusive repercussions on the Indonesian economy. So when we looked at the survey, I think because of that experience, Indonesians were among the lowest in terms of countries who would be looking forward, their interest in TPP, for instance. Not much interest right now. And I think that's because Indonesia believes that it's time. Its time has come, and that you should come to Indonesia and do business in Indonesia. But Indonesia is not ready exactly to trade. I think the Chinese have really alarmed the Indonesians with the nine dash line tipping the Natuna islands and the Natuna Sea. And we see that Indonesian leaders are now coming out and talking about this very openly, including the head of the TNI, Muldoko. The other thing that the Chinese have done recently is send warships through the straits of the Sunda Straits and the Lombok. Thanks. I'm trying to think of nice places to go. And I was thinking Bali, but Lombok is just as nice. And I think that really did alarm the Indonesians, although they played it off as if they sort of understood and it wasn't a problem, but they were very alarmed by it.
The woman in the green right near the door is there.
Thank you. My name is Zhang Hong from China's Taishi Media. So I wonder if the panelists could give us an assessment of how much the Russian pivot to East Asia increased China's leverage or China's perception of its leverage in having its way in South China Sea and perhaps also in East China Sea, in particular on the military front, when we're seeing Russian-Chinese joint drill in East China Sea recently. And actually, there was an interesting incident just before the joint drill. There was a report that a senior Russian military official saying that the drill was going to be held in South China Sea. So that could be a mistake, but do you think that's a genuine mistake or is it not something? Thank you.
To jump in. My own view is that even the Chinese have questions about any kind of Russian, pivot to the East. And I think what comes out of the recent summit between Presidents Xi and Putin are several things. One, it is clear to me that the Chinese feel very comfortable that they are now the dominant partner in that relationship, and that I think they probably believe the Russians acknowledge that. What is interesting about it, however, my understanding of the gas deal is that China, of course, felt to some degree, especially the negotiating parties inside China, CNPC, the various ministries that handle that, that they had the Russians over a barrel, no pun intended, with regard to the gas deal. And especially on price, right, which has been the factor that has caused the deal to fall apart now for 10 years, and because of Russia's difficulties in Europe, et cetera. And you get the feeling that President Putin didn't come away too disappointed. So my sense is that, in fact, there was a political concession made by the Chinese. And it's clear in the agreement itself that the Chinese did something that they didn't want to do, which was agree to a formula by which the price would be linked to the price of oil. That's how it is on the European side. Chinese were seeking to avoid that. They did make this political concession. So it says something about the relationship between the two. I think, unlike what I mentioned a few moments ago about some of the concerns perhaps about the United States president, there I do believe Xi Jinping has some sort of a relationship. There's some sort of chemistry between the two presidents. That's, I think, very clear from watching them interact. I think it has something to do with the fact that President Putin also is a decisive person. He's someone who's in control of his own system, however he's chosen to design it, and does what he says. And I think Xi Jinping sees himself as a very similar individual. That said, I don't think the Chinese are blind to the traditional challenges in the Russia-China relationship. I do think that what we're seeing with China's evolving approach toward Russia is an effort to maintain what you might call an active Russia card underneath the broader umbrella of Sino-US relations, actually. And because they recognize still the power disequilibrium between the US and China, and Russia can be helpful in that context. And I guess I would suggest that if in our own management of our relationship with the Chinese, we are foolish enough to allow that to exist, that's our own fault. Any others?
So the so 2 points about the Russian so-called pivot to Asia. The first is in terms of the relationship with China, I would agree with many of the things that Ernie said. I would also say that for both Beijing and Moscow, this is more of a tactical tilt, more than something I think that is deeper and strategic. And as Chris said, I mean, all you have to do is look at the history of this relationship. And I'm not very confident that the cooperation will sort of be deep and long term. It's a very challenging relationship. The second aspect of the pivot is Russia's pivot to North Korea, in the sense of forgiving North Korean debt and trying to do some infrastructure deals there. And the only thing I can say is more power to you if if you want to consider a part of your pivot the move to North Korea.
Does anyone else in the back of the room there have a question? Doesn't look like it. Okay, back up front. The gentleman right here in the green sweater.
Steve Winters, local researcher. Because the panel has mentioned confusion, I'd suggest there's confusion on the part of China about the U.S. Position. I remember going back to, say, the height of the bubble in Japan, say, 25 years ago, the Japanese had a dream of sort of being, some leaders there, of becoming the leading country in Asia, leading the development of Asia, so forth. This was quite clear at the time. And that, as I recall, led to some friction with the U.S., for instance, arguments over where to place the Asian Development Bank headquarters, so forth and so on. So I think this unclarity has been there for some right. Is the U.S. actually have a position to say we don't want a regional hegemon to evolve in Asia? That's our position? Or so forth and so on. Maybe you could address that, because I'm sure she's wondering about it.
I mean, I think it's at least been a stated part of U.S. strategy going back to the last four East Asian strategy reviews that have been done. There hasn't been one done in a while, but that's certainly been the stated U.S. position, I think.
Go ahead, Matt.
Just to clarify, I mean, I think the Japan situation, you've muddled a few different issues there. One is about Japan's, I think really the period you're talking about is 1997-98, after the Asian financial crisis, when there was an effort by Japan to promote the idea of an Asian Monetary Fund, not the Asian Development Bank, Asian Monetary Fund, which Washington saw as in competition potentially with the IMF and worried about sort of discipline and so forth. And so I think that was a very specific challenge. I don't think there was a broader concern about Japan as a hegemon in Asia. So I just want to clarify that's a very different story from the one today.
Thanks very much. Lin Kwok, Brookings. Today we've been talking about China's emerging great power strategy in Asia. Did you get a sense of an emerging small power strategy towards China? And here I'm talking about the smaller countries of East Asia or ASEAN, or the ASEAN countries. In a recent op-ed, the ambassador at large of Singapore mentioned that the smaller countries of East Asia are not entirely helpless spectators, suggesting, of course, that they are more or less helpless spectators. What are your thoughts on this? What can the ASEAN countries do individually or collectively? And I mean more than just broadly, oh, we don't want to be forced to choose between China and the US. What are the strategies? Did you see any emerging from them? Thank you.
Ernie, I think that's yours.
Thanks, Lynn. Look, I think this is a really important moment for ASEAN. It set itself out for a stronger ASEAN. The ASEAN Charter says that ASEAN will be integrated economically, politically, and socially, and they have benchmarks by 2015. I think that the Chinese fire, you know, the fire of Chinese aggression, these questions that China's asking ASEAN through its actions, not through its words, are a real test for whether ASEAN can find some consensus, that's the right word for ASEAN, a consensus that they need to be stronger. And they can do that in a couple ways. I think you'll have the answer if you see ASEAN decide to do a couple things. One, get rid of their old rule that they only can invest as much as the lowest contributor within ASEAN to the ASEAN Secretariat. Number two, I think you're starting to see ASEAN being more willing to talk about commenting on the internal affairs of its members, because ASEAN has to realize that it's only as strong as its weakest link, which sadly now, amazingly now, happens to be Thailand, which is the interlocutor for China with ASEAN. And I think that's being exploited, quite frankly, if I might say, by our friends in Beijing a bit. And so ASEAN, I think, needs to do some work there. Every opportunity is there for ASEAN to sort of strengthen itself and enhance its relations with strategic partners and enhance its relations with China at the same time. And I think if it does that and continues on the pace, for instance, of the ADMM Plus, which is the ASEAN Defense Ministers Plus, I think we'll see a stronger ASEAN, and so this is what ASEAN can do. I think I could give you a list of other things, including, you know, instead of the ADMM meeting once every 2 years now, it used to meet once every 3 years. It should meet every year, and I think ASEAN should use its architecture, the ASEAN ministers meeting, to make sure, really encourage its partners to come and participate in those meetings. Not only the defense ministers and the foreign ministers at the ARF, but the health ministers, the education ministers, the trade ministers. This will create a habit of coordination on issues that we all can work on together: health, education, infrastructure. This is what we want to be sitting at the table with China and India working on. And that's what I mean when I say economics are the foundation of security. If ASEAN doesn't play that role, I think the region will continue to be plagued by serious existential questions.
Okay, I think we've reached time. I want to thank everyone for their great participation, good questions from the audience. Again, our deep thanks to our friends at the Sasakawa Peace Foundation, and thank you all very much, and please join me in thanking my colleagues.